Director Lloyd Gross, recording date May 18th, 1977. Take one. Little and get her.
From New York City, Joe Garagiola.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, and welcome to Tell the Truth. And as you can see in these cages, we have them filled with parakeets. Now, lots of people own parakeets these days, and the chances are pretty good that their pets came from the hometown of our first guest. And we'll meet our Paragon Parakeeter in a moment, right after we say hello to our panel, okay?
Here is Bill Cullen! Peggy Cass! Frank Field!
Okay, everybody admiring the parakeets, and got one right next to me right here. So I'll tell you what, we're going to just go right into it and say, let's meet, and listen to this introduction. Let's meet a cagey guy.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Gary Scott.
Number two.
Gary Scott.
And number three.
My name is Gary Scott.
Boy, number two didn't fool around. Number three wasn't taking any chances, was he, huh? I tell you what, well, panel, it's up to you to find out who the real Gary Scott is. And here are his paragraphs on parakeets. I, Gary Scott, raise and sell parakeets. Would you believe that we sell about 10,000 birds a week for pets? Parakeets come in 90 different colors, and they're smart, too. One parakeet I know has a 4,000-word vocabulary. I raise him in Waurika, Oklahoma, the parakeet capital of the world. And it was in Waurika where we featured the greatest parakeet show on earth. Everyone agreed that it was strictly for the birds. Signed, Gary Scott. Just wondering if you had an Italian parakeet, if he did 4,000 words, what would he use, his feet instead of his hands? Those kind of things get to me. And we're going to find out more about Gary Scott, but first, let's listen to these great messages. Never mind. They're all checking the parakeets here, but it's not here we're worried about. It's over there with the caged parakeets are three fellas, and one of them is Gary Scott. And he raises and he sells the popular pet. And we're going to start off with our weatherman who always brings his cold air masses from Canada. And today he's going to bring us some questions.
Little
Frank
hot
Field,
air.
Yes.
Number one, Joe Garagiola has a vocabulary of 3,000 words. You say you have a parakeet with a vocabulary of 4,000.
That's correct.
Nice, Frank.
All right. Number two, what kind of temperature would one raise a parakeet in? What's the ideal climate?
There really isn't an ideal climate, but most people try to keep them at room temperature.
Number three, what's one of the big problems in maintaining parakeets? What kind of diseases are they prone to?
Well, it's commonly known as parrot disease, parrot fever.
Psittacosis?
Yes, sir.
I made it up. Number one. number one, why do they call the bird a parakeet?
Well, the parakeet originally comes from Australia, and the correct name is the Australian shell parakeet.
Kitty.
Number one, you mean to say to me that any of those birds can talk
4,000 words?
Not every bird.
But what do they say when they talk?
Well, whatever you teach them. You have to take a baby parakeet. A lot of people are mistaken by buying adult parakeets, and they try to teach them to talk, and you cannot teach an adult parakeet to talk.
Well, number two, what do your parakeets say to you?
Whatever you teach them.
Well, number two, how long do they live?
Oh, about 15 years if something doesn't happen to them.
Uh-huh. Number three, can they bear to live alone, or do they live better if there are two of them at once, male and female?
They live better together.
They enjoy themselves more.
Yes, as a male and female, they enjoy themselves together. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I love that sentence. Did you love that sentence? Okay, Bill.
I like to pursue how they enjoy themselves. No. Number three, you say you can teach a parakeet to say most anything. Are there any sounds that a parakeet cannot make?
Yes.
What, pray tell, are they, number three?
I don't know. I'd probably have a lot of trouble teaching them to say Bill Cullen.
Oh, really? Number two, when you buy a parakeet, aside from its health and its age, what else, if you buy one that talks, what else enters into the price?
Well, the color, for one thing.
Number two, do minor birds talk? Do they have a larger vocabulary than a parakeet?
A minor bird has an excellent vocabulary. I don't believe it's any better than a parakeet.
Number one, when you buy a used bird, you can buy a pre-trained bird. Is that not so?
That is correct.
How much would a parakeet cost me with a vocabulary of, say, 400 words, number one?
A lot would depend on the pet shop, the person that came into the pet shop, but could run you anywhere from $50 to $200.
Number two, isn't 4,000...
Buzzer, and let's go to Peggy K.
Thank you. Number two, can all of these birds here talk?
No, they cannot.
Which ones can talk that are here?
None of these particular birds do talk.
Oh, didn't bring us your finest, right?
That's correct.
Okay. Now, number three, I think this snow white one here is absolutely beautiful. Now, how much would that bird be? Considering it can't say anything, I want a good price.
In Manhattan, probably about $12.
Oh, that's not bad. Now, number one, what do the English people, you know, like, oh, you see little English spinsters with these birds. What's the name? What do they call them over there?
In England?
Yeah.
That I do not know.
Oh, thank you. Number three, do you know?
Parakeets.
Number three, boy, he's a beauty, isn't he? Well, I tell you what, they're going to have to vote. They're going to have to mark their ballots. And what do you think? Do you think it's number one? Or do you think it's number two? Or do you think it's number three? Now, we pay $50 for each incorrect vote and $500 if all the votes are wrong. Now, Dr. Frank Field, you got us started. How did you vote?
All right, I'm taking number two. He seemed to know a little more about parakeets, so just a hunch.
Okay, just a hunch. Kitty?
Well, they were all very good, and they all had sort of Western accents, Middle Western accents. I went for number two. I don't think a bird like that would cost $50 to $200, even though he can talk a little bit.
Okay. Bill Cullen.
Well, you know, we have a rule on this show that if we have seen some of the people on the show, whether they're right or wrong, we can question but not vote. Well, I have to disqualify myself because I met one of those gentlemen in the men's room, which...
What has that got to do with this?
Well, I want you to know where I met the man. Because you might...
How do you answer Kitty's question?
How'd you know he was the real one?
He had his bird in his hand.
Boy, that's 15 yards. Illegal use of the mouth, boy.
Oh,
in a penalty box. Okay. All right, Peggy, try to save the show. This is a family show.
Well, oh, Bill.
Oh, Bill Cullen.
Well, I happen to know that in England they call these dogs. These dear sweet little birds, budgerigars or budgies. So I voted for number two, you filthy thing.
I tell you, we're just not going to be, we're not going to be around for, let's ask that question. Will the real Gary Scott please stand up? Okay. All right. Gary, while you get ready, he's going to get ready for a demonstration. And there's another way to say it, with this bird, the parakeet. And we'll find out who the imposter, Cullen, you're ruining it for everybody. Number one, what is your name and what do you do?
My name is Walt Hudson. I'm originally from Columbia, South Carolina. I now work in New York City for Fieldcrest Mills.
Uh-huh. Number three, what is your name and what do you do?
My name is Troy Ferguson, and I'm originally from Rock Hill, South Carolina. I'd never seen him before yesterday. And I'm a country music singer. I'm the leader of the group known as Troy Ferguson, Sue Smith, and the Country Gentlemen. And we work in Manhattan.
Ah, okay. Let's find out about the parakeet and Gary Scott. Gary, you got one in your hand.
Yes, sir, I sure do.
Now, first of all, are you hurting that bird? Look like you're squeezing it.
Not at all. I've just barely got a hold of it. This
just barely got a hold of it.
This is so it can't bite me.
Now, how do I know if I'm buying, is this a baby or an adult?
This is an adult bird. The way you would tell whether it's a baby or not would be the lines across its forehead. It would be a baby bird if it had lines going across its forehead, black lines.
What are you doing by spreading his wing? Is that the way you buy a bird?
This is so that people can see that it's fully feathered and in good shape, you know.
Now, how much would that bird cost?
About $10, $12.
Hey, that's pretty good. That'd be worth buying. It's a pretty one. Gary, thank you very much, and I'm sorry you had to meet Bill Cullen in the men's room there, but thank you very much for playing our game, and thank you, our two imposters. Oh, boy. Well, I tell you what, our next guest says he has a solution to one of the biggest problems facing the United States, the oil shortage. So that ought to make you stick around. See, we are still here, and we're glad you came back, because right now we're going to meet a man with an answer to our gasoline shortage.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is John Ware Lincoln.
Number two?
My name is John Ware Lincoln.
And number three?
My name is John Ware Lincoln.
Listen now to John Ware Lincoln's Fuel for Thought. I, John Ware Lincoln, have a solution to one of the major issues facing the United States, the oil shortage and rising gasoline prices. The answer is methanol, or wood alcohol. When added to gasoline in a 10% solution, it can significantly decrease pollution, increase mileage, and requires no engine changes. And what's even more important, methanol can be made from solid waste. And if 90% of all such waste were converted to methanol, our dependence on foreign oil for motor fuel would be totally eliminated. I've expounded my theories in a book entitled Methanol and Other Ways Around the Gas Pump. Signed, John Ware Lincoln. I tell you, if we start using solid waste and I tell that gas station guy to fill it up, I ain't gonna look, I'll tell you that.
It won't look like that by the time you get it.
You've been hanging around Bill Cullen. Let's begin the questioning with Kitty Carlisle.
He's corrupted everybody, it's true. Now, Mr. Lincoln, number one, if this is true, why hasn't it been adopted yet? It seems so logical the way it's just been explained.
The need for it hasn't arisen until very recently.
Well, but the need is here now. Number two, why hasn't it been adopted universally?
Well, that's because the production of methanol at this point is very limited. It's about 1 billion gallons.
Number three, is it expensive to convert solid waste into methanol?
It's expensive at the moment, but with proper development, if it were done in the volume that gasoline is, it would be considerably cheaper.
And number two, what would it add to our fuel bill then, when we added this to the ordinary gas?
Quite a considerable amount at this time, but later period it could be much less.
Thank you. Number one, is it not true that solid waste has been converted into building blocks for houses and things like that?
Yes, but at a certain expense.
Well, is your...
Whoop, buzzer. Now let's go to Silver Tongue Cullen.
Sir, if you'll pardon the expression. Sir, is methane gas the gaseous form of methanol? Number three, excuse me, I should have...
Yes, it is.
Staying with you, number three, is there any place now where methanol generators are in use on a small scale for private use?
Yes, there's a number of places where methanol is used at the present time.
Number one, do you know where they would be primarily, number one?
Yes, most of the chemical companies have methanol production.
On a private sense, number one.
Yes,
would that be? Just for an individual.
In boat yards, a great deal of methanol is provided for antifreeze.
Number two, do people on their farms create methanol or methane gas?
No, they do not.
Is there any relationship between methanol and swamp gas or methane and swamp gas?
Yeah, they're all gaseous forms.
Number three, on a farm, can't...
Buzzer, and let's go to Peggy.
Now, number one, are the big gas companies for this?
No, not entirely.
Well, I mean, would they support it, or are they think it's a rotten idea?
At least two of them are able to blend other things with gasoline now.
Well, now, number three, would a 10% decrease in the use of gasoline in this country absolutely eliminate the oil shortage?
It would reduce considerably the oil shortage. It would, so far as the use in automobiles.
Thank you. Number two, is methylated, this stuff, is it the same as methylated spirits that the drunks use?
No, it is not.
Oh, because that, I think, is cheap, but not cheap enough to use in your tank. Number three, what is your... It's cheap enough to use in their tanks. Number three, what is your background?
I have a Master of Science.
And number one?
I have a Bachelor of Architecture, Bachelor of Science.
Thank you. Now, number two...
Buzzer, Frank Field.
Number one, in order to burn this fuel, what kind of engine would you need?
In blends of the mixture, no changes are necessary.
Number two, what kind of an engine would you need in order to burn this special kind of fuel?
We can convert the present engine for about $100.
Number three, is there an engine that can burn this fuel?
Yes, the internal combustion engine can be modified to burn the fuel.
Number three, is manure a good source of... Excuse me, Bill. Is manure a good source of methane?
Yes.
For this production. Number two, did you say that there was a place in somewhere where this is being used? It was Bill's earlier question.
Well, it's being currently used in West Germany.
Number one, how much of this material can be produced in a short time?
A billion gallons a year is produced now. That's 1% of the gasoline production.
Well, that means that our game's over. Now it's time to vote. Do you think it's number one? Or do you think it's number two? Or do you think it is number three? $50 each incorrect vote, $500 if all the votes are wrong. And Kitty, you got us started. How did you vote?
Well, very often, very clever inventors only have a BA, and I think that he knew about 1% of all the fuel being used now is that methanol gas. So I voted for number one.
Number one, all right. Bill Cullen.
Well, numbers one and two didn't seem to either, perhaps it was the way I phrased my question, be aware of the methane generators or things like that they have on farms, and they do. Both also using other farm waste or garbage and things like that. So number three, I didn't get a chance to ask him. I voted for him.
Okay. Peggy.
Well, I thought they were all adorable, but I thought number one was really terrific.
Okay.
Well, I voted... I voted for number three because I did not meet him in the men's room, and...
the logic on this show, you just can't argue with it. All right, that's kind of unique. The ladies voted for one, the men voted for three. And we'll find out now when we ask that great question, will the real John Ware Lincoln please stand up? Ah! Let's find out who the imposters are. Number two, what is your name and what do you do, sir?
My name is Dr. William H. Van Precht. I'm a psychoanalytic psychotherapist at the Adler Clinic in New York City.
And number three, what is your name and what do you do, sir?
I'm Ralph Chamberlain. I'm Director of Development for the Salvation Army.
Mr. Lincoln, let me ask you, how far away are we from this? Are we ever going to get there? Won't the big gasoline company stop you from it?
No, we could start doing it tomorrow in a very small way, adding a small percentage of methanol or one of the other alcohols to our gasoline. The engine of an internal combustion car is very tolerant. It's already accepted large proportions of this during the last war in Europe.
Are you receiving opposition now to your idea from anybody?
None at all.
None at all. Well, are we close or are we pretty far away from it?
There are several bills before Congress to initiate methanol production.
Mm-hmm. Well, we thank you for coming by and playing our game. We thank you, our two imposters. Thank you very much.
Our central characters today will receive this FM-AM portable with TV band from General Electric. Lets you enjoy TV sound without a TV set. In the kitchen, outside, or anywhere. And Joe DiMaggio says Mr. Coffee with exclusive coffee savers saves coffee, saves money. And Bissell's revolutionary new Century 2 sweeper cleans to the wall and around furniture with unique corner brushes. Sweeps all floor surfaces. Bissell.
Now, you have to admit that this show was a bit unique, thanks to our good friend, Mr. Bill Cullen. Bill, we thank you and you and your friends. We'll see you again. So long, everybody.
In addition to the Cash Awards, our first team of challengers will receive Sarah Coventry, the exclusive fashion jewelry you can buy from the brand. Sarah Coventry, jewelry with know-how. And our second team will receive Turtle Wax Super Hard Shell Car Wax Kit with high-speed applicator, a pre-whip formula that cleans, waxes, and seals in the shine from Turtle Wax. This is Alan Calder speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.